Hi. Imagine having partial measurements of a high-dimensional complex dynamical system. Say you have a few sensors submerged in a turbulent flow. Or maybe you can track a few particles in a complex granular material flow. Or maybe you have EEG measurements or fMRI measurements of the brain, and you'd like in all these systems to understand the underlying dynamics, the high-dimensional dynamics. This sounds like an almost impossible task, but this is exactly the problem we tackle in our recent paper, Discovering Governing Equations with Deep Delay Autoencoders. Now, this is work I've done with my colleagues, Kathleen Champion, Nathan Kutz, and Stephen Brunton. The basic idea is you have some measurements, let's say one-dimensional measurements, y of t, and you can embed these measurements in a higher dimensional space by time delay embedding. And we know that this time delay embedding coordinates with time series h of t is diffeomorphic to the original full state dynamics z of t. We know that because there's a theorem that says it, Dawkins' embedding theorem. And we know that we can go from h to z back and forth using an invertible function, phi and psi. Some continuous, nonlinear continuous function. Now, we also know that given data in the full state attractor or coordinates, we can learn the dynamics z dot equals f of z. Now, f is an unknown function. It's an analytical unknown function. Phi and psi are also unknown functions. And what we're proposing here is to learn all these functions from data. And the only given data is y of t. Of course, this is a highly ill-posed problem. And here, the art is all about designing the loss function to optimize for this and to recover the full state attractor along with the dynamical system that underlies it. So how does that work? Let's say you have one-dimensional measurements y of t. And here I'm showing these measurements being shifted in time, like shifting a window towards positive time. And let's highlight four of these measurements as we're shifting them in time, y of t plus tau, y of t plus 2 tau, y of t plus 3 tau. So here I'm taking four, but you can take more. What you can do is take these four points in one dimension and project them on a higher dimensional space as one point in these in this four-dimensional delay coordinates. So now we have this one point in four dimensions that is an embedding of these four points in 1D. Now, as I said earlier, we know that the full-state attractor from which this one-dimensional measurements came, this is the higher-dimensional system, we know that this coordinate system is diffeomorphic to this coordinate system, because of Dawkins' embedding theorem. We also know that given data in the full state coordinates, we can discover the underlying dynamics using sparse identification of nonlinear dynamics, or also known as SINDy. For example, in the example illustrated here, this is the Lorenz system. It's a three-dimensional system with three unknown parameters. So, now, how do we actually develop this method? It seems like there are a lot of unknowns. The diffeomorphism is unknown. The sparse identification of nonlinear dynamics is also a machine learning algorithm with unknown coefficients. And the delay embedding is also, there is no unique way of doing that. There's the number of dimensions that we choose is unknown, and tau is unknown. So for validation, we start with a known dynamical system, high-dimensional dynamical system, and we project it on 1D. For example, we can take z1 to be actually y of t, and then therefore closing the loop and developing and refining each one of these pieces so that we can, at some point, discover a method that works for dynamical systems that we don't know. So let's focus on each one of these parts in this cycle. So we know that time delay embedding is possible. It's all a matter of choosing the dimensions. So we can, in this case, define the Hankel matrix. The Hankel matrix, each column in the Hankel matrix is one data point in the delay coordinates. So here we have Q q data points, and we can write this time series in the delay coordinates as h1, h2 to hq. Here I'm showing a continuous attractor, but in reality this will also be discrete. Why use time delay embedding? This technique has been used extensively, for example, to show to highlight the difference between chaos and noisy dynamics or noise. And recently, my colleagues showed that chaos can be cast as an intermittently forced linear system using time delay embedding or using the dominant modes of the Hankel matrix. I encourage you to look at this paper. It's very interesting. And on the other hand, we have the sparse identification of nonlinear dynamics method, or SINDy, that takes data in full state coordinates or any coordinate system and tries to discover the underlying dynamics F using a form of sparse regression. So if you don't know about this method, I encourage you to look at this paper. But here I'm going to briefly illustrate how it works. So you start with a data matrix where you have a time series z1, z2 to zq. And you define a dictionary. The dictionary will include z1, z2, z3, z1 times z2, z1 cubed, etc. All these possibilities. You can also have sine of z. And derivatives in other independent variables, like if you have x, and you can get a PDE, in fact. And at the end, you cast this problem as in the form of this differential equation, where xi now is a matrix of unknown coefficients. And what we're trying to do is optimize for these unknown coefficients to fit the data. So we're optimizing this loss function, where we minimize the residual squared of the differential equation. And we also try to minimize the number of terms in the differential equation, therefore maximizing sparsity. So SINDy has been improved extensively in recent years. And there are, of course, it's an active area of research. How do you discover the best differential equation that underlies a given dynamics in any coordinate system? Now, the last piece of this puzzle is this diffeomorphism. We know that it exists, but we don't know what it is. So how do we go from this side to this side? We don't know exactly what it looks like, but we know that it's very nonlinear. And we know that this coordinate system will probably be much higher will certainly be much higher dimensional than this coordinate system. In fact, the Tauchin's embedding theorem says that this coordinate system should be at least two times the dimension of this coordinate system plus one. So if this is three, this has to be at least seven. And what better than a neural network to make that approximation? More specifically, a sort of encoder. Now, we know that a neural network can do the job, because if we know both sides of this equation, we show in the paper that you can actually do this fitting really well, and it generalizes well. And we also show that you can actually do this transform using a combination of SVD decomposition and a neural network, so that you make a linear compression of that coordinate system, and then you make the rest with a nonlinear transformation using an encoder. So now that we saw all of these puzzles, let's kind of summarize it and highlight what we're looking for. So we have an unknown system. Here we know the equations, but in reality we don't. And we're just making one-dimensional measurements, y of t. Let's say this is going to be x1, for example. So we time delay embed y into h, and then we have an encoder that takes us from h to z. Then we can map z to z dot with this analytical function f, therefore discovering a nonlinear dynamical system. And then we should be also able to go from z back to h. This makes this an encoder, an autoencoder. And f is, of course, an analytical function. So that's the SINDy part. So it's a SINDy autoencoder. And it uses delay coordinates. So it's a delay SINDy autoencoder. Now, after doing that reconstruction, you have, of course, to minimize all these three functions. Now, to show you our results, for example, concerning the Lorenz system, we discover something that looks like the original system. Of course, this is an ill-posed problem again. And there are a lot of diffeomorphisms that are similar to the original Lorenz. And what we're assuming here is that the optimal solution given a certain loss function is similar, at least has some invariance that is shared with the original system. And you can notice that the discovered system here is even sparser than the original system. And we can look at the system and make predictions for at least the first dimension and gain some insight as to the structure of the attractor, something that we cannot do with one dimension only. Now, this work is based on previous work. This is a very similar architecture to the SINDy autoencoder developed in this paper, done by my colleagues. So please look at this paper as well before you dive deeper into this work. All right, let's dive a little deeper. How do we actually do that? Because it's all about defining the loss function. What is the loss function that allows us to go from one-dimensional measurements to three-dimensional dynamical, dynamical system equations? So we have y, we delay embed y in h, and we said we can go from h to z using a combination of SVD and encoder, or just an encoder. And we can do that back to h, thus having an autoencoder. Now, the SINDy part is taking z and projecting it on a higher dimensional space by defining this dictionary, potential terms on, in our differential equation, and then multiplying it by this unknown function xi that we're also optimizing for to get z dot. Now, we can also go back to h to constrain our model even further. You can see in the original paper of delay autoencoders that it's useful to take the derivative of the input data, h dot, and by automatic differentiation to get z dot. The details of how you go from here to here are explained in the paper. Now, you can do the same thing to go from z dot to h dot. And you can notice that there are a lot of redundancies. There's z dot, a z bar dot, an h dot, an h bar dot, and an h bar, and an h. So we want all of these to be the same. We don't want the redundancies. So this is what defines our loss functions. So first, we minimize the difference between z dot and z bar dot. And you can derive these as a function of the input h and the functions phi, psi, and xi. We also want to minimize the difference between h dot and h bar dot, as well as the reconstruction loss between h bar and h. Now, there's one last loss we can also add to constrain our model even further, which is to take the latent variable z and to integrate it using the discovered model like this. So now we have z would be this latent variable at a given epoch or at a given training step is defined as z at t0. And then we integrate that in time using the SINDy coefficients xi. And we get these time steps or the solution z hat at t1 until z hat at tn. And we want the first dimension of this solution to be also the input data, which means that we would like our discovered model to have the first dimension match the input data that we're giving it. This is, of course, an assumption, but it constrains our model even further to get something that makes sense. So let's look at what the algorithm actually does. So here we initialize our neural network to map to the dominant modes in the latent variable. And starting from that approximation, we try to train the algorithm to find the most optimal solution given those losses. Of course, there's something I didn't mention also, that we're minimizing the sparsity of the solution. So here, the full system is unknown, of course. We're just measuring the x dimension, the first dimension. And the yellow curve is the latent variable, and the red curve is the integrated SINDy model. So you can see that SINDy does a good job learning from the latent variable. But of course, with time, as the system is trying to minimize the sparsity of the solution, the attractor slowly drifts away from the original system because it has no information as to the other dimensions. And here comes the important part about improving method. As you can see, the model that's discovered here is different from the model that I showed you before. And this is to highlight the fact that the solution is not going to be unique depending on how you weigh your losses, which losses you include, and for example, the architecture of the neural network, the dimension of the embedding. There are so many hyperparameters. But given a system, if you know, for example, that the energy is conserved, you can bake in those symmetries, physics-informed symmetries in the loss function, and therefore improve that discovery and get it closer and closer to the original system. I think this method is a good start to start from somewhere. to say that the origin system has this kind of structure, has these kind of terms in the differential equation. And as we try to improve our data-driven modeling methods, we find more and more refined models that are higher dimensional from our measurements, but have a structure that describes the physics. So we tried also, we also tried this on the Lorenz waterwheel. So we took this video from YouTube, from the Harvard Natural Sciences lecture demonstrations. And we took that video and we wanted to extract one-dimensional measurement, which is the angle of this video. Ideally, we'll take the video and pass it through some kind of encoder, CNN encoder, and immediately extract the latent variable, one latent variable, which is the angle. But in this case, we use a machine learning algorithm to detect the lines and to cluster the lines and to discover the angle of those lines. And you can see this is a very noisy kind of measurement. And when we extract those measurements with the angular velocity here, we have noise, so we have to kind of smooth the data. But from that smooth data, we use our algorithm and we discover an attractor. And here we're showing the model solution using SINDy and the latent variable. Of course, this is kind of a butterfly-shaped attractor, but there's a lot of improvements that can be done to get closer to the original Lorentz system. And this is the discovered analytical model. So this is I'm very excited about this work to apply it to problems where we actually don't know the solution. We don't know the underlying dynamics. And if you have that data, I would be very excited to collaborate with you to discover the underlying dynamics of your complex system. And if you have ideas on improving this method, I encourage you to look at the paper and to give me ideas and to pitch ideas and to collaborate, because this is what research is all about. So thank you.